commissions. Great. And now we are recording. Perfect. So tonight is that we're getting really into a lot of the weeds, talking about PUCs with some really great experts. And we can go to the next slide. Next one. Great. So we'll start with some introductions, and then we will have our three guest instructors give presentations about different aspects of public utility commissions, and then we'll have some Q&A and some next steps. So really looking forward to everyone engaging tonight. So some requests, just to remove any distractions if possible. I know it can be difficult, especially in the evening. There's lots going on. And also just get yourself comfortable, get a beverage, center yourself. And if you want to pull up your utility bill, seriously, like these things are very real. They're very tangible. It can help to kind of bring it back down to our daily lives. Great. And so my name is Taylor Smith-Hams. I use she, her pronouns. I am a US senior organizer with 350.org, and I'm based in Baltimore. And yeah, and so before we get started with our presentations, we would love to just hear a little bit from everyone here about what makes you excited about taking on utilities. You can just put in the chat what makes you excited about, why are you here, why you want to take these behemoths on. Second largest source of greenhouse gas emissions, slow global warming. Yeah, definitely. Yep. Utilities are absolutely key to making or breaking our renewable energy transition. We depend on them, but they shouldn't profit from that. Love that. California utility bills are now highest in the nation. Yeah, this really hits people like in the pocketbook. This is a really, really important issue. They've blocked major climate bills. They give a lot of money to right-wing politicians. Everyone has a right to affordable, clean energy. Energy transition should benefit all people, not just the rich. Yeah, these are all awesome. Yeah, breaking up the Duke monopoly. Yeah, all of these great reasons. You're all in the right place. We are going to dig into how to take on these utility companies tonight. Thank you all so much for being here and for sharing. So I am just going ahead and get us started with our first speaker. So I'm really excited to introduce Nancy LaPlaca, who has 40 years of public policy experience, including 19 with electric and gas utility issues specifically. She served as a policy advisor to an elected public utilities commissioner and was a public interest intervener at state level public utility commissions in Arizona, Colorado, and North Carolina. So lots of expertise. Including coal ash, methane gas, power plants, net metering, you name it. Nancy has created and taught three university level courses on energy policy and climate, as well as a series in late 2021, when you can view all of this stuff on her LinkedIn profile, which we will link to. So without any further ado, welcome Nancy.
Thanks so much, Taylor, and thank you everyone for your time. And I am going to give what I hope is the briefest history ever of the US electricity and make it entertaining. And one of the reasons why I think it's important to understand this is that we are at an inflection point right now. And 100 years ago, when the US electricity system was first created, and we're on slide 9 here, Taylor, it was also a time of great change. And the push-pull at that time was the investor-owned utilities, the private utilities, who were fighting the city utilities, the government utilities. And so we're at kind of the same type of inflection point. So again, the history of US electricity system is about 100 years old. The first power plants came online in the 1880s, and utilities were natural monopolies. And why? And what do I mean by that? Well, because when utilities first came to be in New York. There's a great photo of all these power lines running all over the place in New York. And this is like the 1920s. So you still had a lot of horses. So you had horse poop. You had all these wires all over the place. It was very dangerous. And so the utilities were seen as natural monopolies because, first of all, it costs so much to build everything. And second of all, because if you had too many power lines, too many power plants, you are just going to drive up costs and not necessarily give people any better service. So they started out as natural monopolies, but I would say they aren't anymore, not even close. I'm going to do a quick rundown here from the 1920s to the 1970s, because it was a very it was very tumultuous in the 20s and 30s, and then it was pretty quiet from about the 30s until the 70s. So I want to mention someone named Samuel Insull, who was an aide to Thomas Edison. And he's the guy who kind of thought up this whole system of state regulators. And there are historians of utilities who tell stories about how Samuel Insull and his colleagues knew that when they made electricity regulation at the state level, that they were actually helping themselves because it would be easier to manipulate. And so they knew darn well what they were doing. So in the 30s, there was a huge change because the electric utilities were a big part of the crash of 29. And in the 30s, FDR, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, did a couple things. One, he started rural electrification because it was too expensive for utilities to have so much power lines for so few customers. So the rural electric utilities brought electricity to the rural areas. The other thing that happened that's pretty quiet, and I have a link in here, is the PUCA. That's the Public Utility Holding Company Act of 1935. Why is that important? Because it said that you can't have markets with no competition, which is what we have right now. That law was repealed by the Bush administration in 2005. And so that's why a utility like Duke Energy can own Piedmont Gas and the power plants, and they own the pipelines, and then they contract for the gas. So the reason, so PUHCA, the Public Utility Holding Company Act, is really important. And one of my heroes, Tyson Slocum from Public Citizen, talks about how it really is leading to our current crisis, where we have this consolidation of power, and that if PUCA was not repealed, we would not have that problem. I also want to mention something else, and that's something that happened starting in 1990, and that's deregulation. And the idea was that deregulation would reduce costs, but honestly, the truth is more complex, because if you look at the reports that talk about regulated states versus deregulated states, there's maybe a fraction of a cent difference. Now, the era that we're in now, we're talking about skyrocketing natural gas costs. We're talking about electricity rates that are going way up, way down, way up, way down. There's so much volatility in the market that it's obvious that there's change going on and that change has to happen. Now, one of the reasons why I'm bringing up deregulated states also is because 70% of the customers in the United States are in deregulated states. And so if you are in one of those deregulated states, and I put a link in there, then you are subject to the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, which we won't get into today, but there are other groups, including Third Act, who I work with, and we are doing a lot of education about ISOs and RTOs, these independent system operators, regional transmission operators, because they're so important. So let's go to the next slide here, Taylor, slide 10. So what are they and why should I care? Well, it sounds like you guys know, because they're the deciders. And because they've been so under the radar, you know, Dave Roberts calls it the force field of tedium, public utilities commissions. I heard Bill McKibben say one day, who in their right mind would read LNG reports? And I had to laugh out loud because I've been reading LNG reports for years. But these PUCs have really kind of gotten away with a lot because they're so under the radar. There's so much jargon. And if you're going to jump in, it is complex. And that's why it's so great that there's all of us working on this together. And I want to emphasize that even if you just send a comment, even if you just show up at a hearing, even if you just send a note to a public utilities commissioner, I know I work for one, no one shows up, but the utilities are there every single day. And if you counted up all the lobbyists for the utilities compared to the commissioners, it's at least 10 to 1. It's probably more like 20 to 1. Because why? Those are the guys who make the decisions. Another funny thing that a colleague said, Mike Jacobs from UCS, Union of Concerned Scientists, really smart guy, been around a long time. Mike said the PUCs only really have one customer, and that's the regulators. And he's right. Those are their only customers because honestly, I don't see that they really care very much what people think, and they're doing their best to shut people out. So, again, here on slide 10, I've got a link so you could see what the deregulated states are. And broadly speaking, public utilities commissions in regulated states have more power over the investor-owned utilities. I'll take my state, North Carolina. Duke Energy is very, very dominant politically, financially, and basically, by being in a regulated state, we have more opportunity in North Carolina to directly challenge Duke Energy at the PUC. Now, if you're talking about affecting a PUC in a deregulated state, again, that's just a little bit more complex. So, what do PUCs not do? Well, they don't do pipeline permits, as I'm sure many of you know who've probably been involved in pipeline fights. They don't give the permits for those natural gas, those fossil gas pipelines. They only oversee safety. They also only oversee interstate, they don't oversee interstate transmission. That's FERC. They don't oversee nuclear issues or permits. They did way back in the 80s. And honestly, there were so many interveners that they dropped that rule. And that's how I started in this work. In the 80s, I helped a friend of mine who was challenging Palo Verde Nuclear Generating Station, which is the largest nuclear power plant in the country, located in Arizona, 4,000 megawatts. And what they also don't do is something that we need to change, and we can change, that only a handful consider environmental, climate change damages, frontline communities, and this is something we can change. So what do PUCs do? Power plant permits. They do resource planning, which is just really long-term planning. Integrated resource planning is just a long way of saying it's going to be a 10-year plan or a 5-year plan. And really, when you look at how much change is going on in the world of electric utilities, having a 10 or 15-year plan is kind of ridiculous right now. Probably a 5-year plan is better. PUCs also do rate cases. That's where they apply to the Utilities Commission to raise your rates, and then there's a hearing about it, and then they get their money. When they get permission, then they're allowed to charge you. Also, renewable portfolio standards, which are a great opportunity for clean energy advocates to weigh in. Even if you don't intervene, again, just to weigh in, show up at a hearing, send a note, write to your commissioner. The other thing that they do that's really been controversial lately is rules on rooftop solar. And, I listened to a podcast the other day, and it was the CEO of Sunrun. Her name is Mary Powell. She's very famous in the world of electric utilities because she used to run Vermont Green Power. She was the most progressive public utilities, utility CEO in the country, bar none. And now she runs Sunrun. And what she talked about is that in Australia, it costs 25% of what it costs in the United States to put up rooftop solar. So let me just say that again. In the United States, compared to Australia, it costs 4 times more to put up rooftop solar. Why? Barriers, bureaucracy, regulators, utilities, permit craziness. So really, there's no reason for this except that we have bad leadership. So batteries are coming more and more to the fore. And one of the reasons why batteries are so important is because batteries are sort of a new, it's a new thing in utilities because it's both a generator, it can send electricity to the grid, and it's also something that can save energy. You can take your solar and put it in the battery, and then you can just use it for later. So it's a type of generator and an energy saving device. And honestly, that's why it's so easy for the utilities to manipulate the rules because batteries are in a category of their own. And then there's energy efficiency, which we've really dropped the ball on in this country because the utilities don't want to do it. And then I also want to mention that power can also be at the state legislature. It depends on the state. I want to mention something else here, that before IRPs, we had this thing called least cost planning. And basically all it meant was coal, 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 and more coal. And one of my first experiences that I will never forget was the first docket I was ever involved in around 2006. It might have been early 2007, getting up at a hearing when the utility said coal is cheap. And it was the opportunity to make a comment. And I got up and said, cheap for who? Who is coal cheap for? It's cheap for the utility. But when you consider that it costs the utility between 3 cents and 5 cents, okay, 3 cents and 5 cents to generate that coal-fired electricity kilowatt hour, but the damages from that coal are 10, 20, 30 cents a kilowatt hour. So we have a problem. There's no reason for this country to still be 20% coal. So something else I want to mention is that we can do things. Right now, we're kind of stuck at the state level because we can't operate in Congress very well. But once we can operate in Congress, and we do have, the three houses of Congress, we could do something like national net metering, a national net metering standard, so we don't have to fight these battles all over the place. So though these elections are incredibly important. Now, slide 11, and I know I'm getting about right to the end here. So why is it hard to change their outcomes? Well, there's a revolving door, and Taylor and the group and I were just talking about an article. I think you put it in the chat, Taylor. And basically, it talks about how bad the utilities are. The PUCs are quasi-judicial agencies. And what that means is it's very difficult to appeal their decisions so that it has to be really, really bad in order to win an appeal at the courts. So what needs to change? Well, we need to get them to care about all the things that we care about. And then slide 12 here, and I will wrap it up. And again, what can we do? Show up. If you're interested in this stuff, there's a ton to learn. There's a lot of great people to work with. I was just talking to Taylor and the gang too about how we have so many incredible experts. We don't have to know everything. There's a lot of great collaboration going on, and I'm just so excited to be part of that. And then my last slide here, slide 13. Is something I like to mention to people because I remember being shocked when I first learned this. We're moving from an era where we boil water to make electricity. Sometimes you use coal to boil the water, or you use nuclear to boil the water, or you use natural gas to boil the water. It's extremely inefficient. 60% of the energy that's in that fuel is lost as heat and pollution. Whereas if you take PV, photovoltaics, anything that it's directly converts to electricity. And that's why electric cars are 80 to 90% efficient. In other words, 80 to 90% of the electricity gets turned into work and moves the car. Whereas it's exactly the opposite on an internal combustion engine car. 80 to 90% is lost as heat and pollution. So I think I hit it. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Nancy. And you can follow Nancy on X or Twitter, and you can also check out her presentations on her LinkedIn profile, which I just put in the chat. So thank you so much. And now we are going to hear from Susan Miller. Susan is a clean energy attorney in Earth Justice's Washington, D.C. office. In this capacity, she represents nonprofits before various state commissions, FERC, and in court proceedings. Susan came to Earth Justice from FERC, and where she served in the general counsel's office. And prior to that, she worked for the Maryland Public Service Commission for 20 years in a variety of roles. And Susan is a graduate of University of Maryland Law School. So welcome, Susan.
Thank you, Taylor. Hello, everybody. I'm glad so many people came out tonight to hear such a boring subject. do you want to go to the first slide, Taylor? Okay. My discussion is going to be sort of why should you care about the PSC and the PUC? First, I want to talk about legislation. I know a number of you have probably worked on legislation before your state legislatures and at times gotten really great legislation, seem to be a potentially do a lot of good, make a lot of changes. Like in Maryland, they had the Climate Solutions Now Act, which was nationally recognized and everything like that. But as I'm sure all of you know, no legislation is self-implementing. And implementation is the key to any the success of any legislation, particularly climate legislation. So where you have to be next is where the minutiae decision makers are. And for climate, that tends to, in a lot of times, be two agencies, essentially your departments of the environment and your public service commission or your public utility commissions. Particularly because so much of climate now is ending the use of gas and converting to electricity and changing how electricity is generated. The PUCs are a big deal with regard to whether you can achieve your climate objectives. Now, most of the PUCs, you can divide them into two general areas. They do evidentiary proceedings and rulemakings, and they're very different on how they occur. Obviously, the utilities have a lot of power, as Nancy, no pun intended, have a lot of power over the commission, and that's in part because no one else shows up. So in general, a lot of times the commission only hears from utilities. And because the commissions are quasi-judicial bodies, they can only make rulings based on the information they've received. Even if they feel there's a gap or something's missing, if they don't have that proof, they can't make decisions. So utilities are there all the time. They have dozens of workers. As a matter of fact, if you live in a state where the ex parte rules aren't very good, ex parte rules are the fact that parties aren't supposed to talk to commissioners while there's a proceeding before the commission on any issues or that are part of that proceeding. But some commissions have awful ex parte rules. Louisiana Public Service Commission has no ex parte rules. You can go talk to them about anything. But the thing is, who has all the employees who can just show up every day at the commission and talk to them? That's the utilities. They talk to the commissioners every day. They make appointments every day. While small nonprofits, they don't have just don't have the personnel to do that all the time. So that's you can switch to the next slide, Tara. That's why the importance of showing up has become more and more important. That they decide whether power plants are going to be built. They decide for replacing gas pipes. They decide whether rates should be increased and who should get those increases. They decided whether to build renewables and how difficult it'll be to build renewables. For example, we have a case in DC where we filed a complaint against Pepco because what they're doing is you have, of course, your rooftop solar has to interconnect in order for you to the wider grid in order for you to sell power. Well, what they were doing to these solar providers is they would tell them a charge for it would cost to interconnect. They would pay that charge. They would build their facilities. Months later, Pepco would come back and say, oh, well, we misestimated. You owe us $2,000 more or thousands of dollars more, which totally tanks the economics of that facility. And so we're at the commission, the DC commission right now saying, you can't do that. You give an estimate, you know, you can say, give 5% or something like that, but you can't just come back months later after the facility's been running and demand more money. The two type of proceedings, as I mentioned, are evidentiary or rulemaking. rulemaking proceedings actually tend to be a little bit easier to participate in because some states like Maryland, you're not even required to have an attorney represent you in a rulemaking. You can comment, you can do written comments, you can show up and do at the hearing and discuss what you think the rules should be, say for community solar or something like that. The difficulty is a lot of rulemakings, once the proposed rules aren't the start is what's often called work groups or something like that, where all the stakeholders are get together and are supposed to discuss what the rules should look like and try to come to consensus before it gets to the commission. And those, of course, take a lot of time. There are a lot of meetings for each set of rules, and there are can be dozens of rules at the same time, which once again makes it difficult for parties who aren't utilities to participate in the initial discussion for what the rules should look like, which that discussion tends to domino into what the commission will ultimately do. So it's important to what we try to do is organize so that different nonprofits are doing different rulemakings, so that there's no reason for all of you to be in one rulemaking if you all tend to agree, so you can divide up the work and to participate, and everyone of course can still write comments and still come to the ultimate hearings, but that way someone's covering the work groups for everyone, so you don't have to everyone trying to do everything. Now, the evidentiary hearings are a little more difficult because in, I'd say 90% of the states probably, you're required to have an attorney represent you. And that's the ones that have expert witnesses who file direct testimony, who get cross-examined. And those are some very important decisions come out of those, and they're very complicated and technical a lot of times. But like we just did a proceeding where the commission was deciding how many millions of dollars BG could spend on replacing gas distributory pipelines, even though the argument was they shouldn't be replacing them at all. They weren't leaking now. BG just assumed that they would leak sometime, so they might as well replace them. And because BG makes a profit on replacing them, but doesn't make a profit on repairing them, they just want to replace everything. So that's, you know, can be a very technical proceeding with regard to engineers and arguments with regard to engineering. But those are the kind of issues that are being decided that impact not only your rates, but they are ultimately going to impact the transition away from gas, because now a company has invested hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars in their gas pipeline, and someone has to pay for that. Whether they're, even in the future, if it doesn't get used, the utility is still entitled to get its money back, which is called stranded costs. So each of those proceedings kind of snowballs into an effect on what the future is that you want to change and how you can change that future and how difficult it is to change that future. So that's where the evidentiary proceedings come in. And that's where, once again, what we try to do is do coalitions that have one attorney. Earth Justice represents other nonprofits free of charge. So we tend to do a lot of the evidentiary proceedings where we find the expert witnesses for people. Oftentimes, if it's a very small nonprofit and the ethical rules allow us, we pay for their expert witnesses so that they can fully participate in the proceeding. But they can be very long proceedings, but they're very important proceedings because they also decide things like whether the utility really needs to build another gas-fired electric plant. And, you know, once they build it, it's going to be in the rates and everyone's going to pay for it. So all those details that are important for rates are also important for down the road. What are we going to do with all these gas plants that the commission has allowed them to build that they've spent money on that they want their money back for? And they can make an argument in court that they're entitled to their money back for. So it's very important to participate in proceedings that maybe at first glance don't seem to be environmental and climate proceedings, because quite frankly, almost everything the commission does will ultimately affect whether the climate objectives can be achieved. So, and the other point of that is very often, I believe Nancy touched on this, very often no one's making environmental arguments. Even if your commission doesn't like environmental arguments, I mean, I've made environmental arguments in states where pretty much they hit me upside the head when I made them, because they weren't interested. But you have to keep going back and making them, because you're gradually making inroads. Sometimes it takes longer than other times, but you have to have them have these discussions come up all the time so that gradually someone gets the idea, well, this should be thought about. And it also gives you the opportunity, if your legislature is better than your commission, to go to the legislature and say, we've tried to get the commission to listen to this, and they just wouldn't. So we need you to tell them they have to. So it bounces back and forth between the commission and the legislature. We, a few years ago in Maryland, got the legislature to pass a change to the commission standard that says they have to consider environmental effects now. That was never in before. And they also took the Office of People's Counsel and said they could raise issues of environmental effects, because traditionally the Office of People's Counsel, which represents residential ratepayers, traditionally their charge or their standard was rates and not other issues, but now that they also have environmental issues as part of their charge. You want to switch to the next slide, Taylor? Rewarding utilities for how much energy they sell. That's what harms energy efficiency. Essentially, you have to find a way to incentivize utilities by changing how they're rewarded or how they make a profit. So they're not making a profit on energy, they're making a profit on the facilities, the electric facilities, so that they will be willing to boost energy efficiency and to make energy efficiency more better and to increase it. You also, the first step to get to transition from gas is to stop investing in expanding it. A number of gas utilities actually help have incentives for to expand the line. So if you wanted to get gas and you don't have gas now, they would actually give you a discount to get the line to your house so that you will become a gas customer. The other thing that commissions rarely have considered in the past and are just kind of starting to focus on in some commissions, and some commissions don't focus it on at all, is energy justice issues. You know, pretty much my understanding is approximately 68% of people of color live near a polluting facility such as a coal-fired power plant. You know, they're always put in poor neighborhoods. As a matter of fact, when we were working on an offshore wind proceeding, one of the things we argued is that this is finally a generation that is no one has to live near that doesn't harm people. This is where we want to put generation. You know, particularly in this instance, generation has no emissions. But you have to stop, not only stop putting facilities in poor areas, but start closing the facilities that are in poor areas so that the air quality of those areas can improve. And of course, the other answer is to force, you can't force, continually try to get the commission to integrate consideration of climate impact into all of its decisions, because the first step is to get them to recognize that all of their decisions impact climate and impact their states, particularly if you live in a state that has set some kind of GHG emissions reduction goals or things like that. Every decision that pretty much that the PUC makes will impact whether the state can achieve those goals. So you want to keep bringing that up and keep reminding them that it's not just, well, is this rate fair from an economic standpoint, from a math calculation standpoint, but is what we're letting the utility do going to help the state achieve its GHG re emissions reduction goals or harm the state's ability to achieve its GHG reduction goals? And so those issues, you have to keep reminding the commission that that's part of their charge, that they are impacting with the state policies and that they have a responsibility to see that state policies are achieved. The state policies that have been put into legislation are their responsibility, even if they don't appear in their statute. So those are the kind of arguments that you make in both rulemaking and in evidentiary proceedings, because they come up in both instances that, you know, you want rules that say encourage community solar. So it's important that the rules are expansive as possible to encourage as much community solar as possible, not only because it enables people who might want solar who can't get it because of their roofs and other reasons, but it helps achieve the GHG reduction. So the arguments tend to start combining in what I view as a good way, because each argument supports the other and supports doing steps that achieve climate goals rather than just achieving what should the utility make for the next year or the next 3 years. I think that's all I had, and I tend to talk fast. I'm sorry.
Oh, that was awesome. Thank you so much, Susan. Great. So now we are going to hear from John Kwa. So John is a community organizer who's worked for 12 years on campaigns for climate, housing, and racial justice organizations, or with organizations, including 350, the Sunrise Movement, and Global Zero. He's currently the campaign director for Lead Locally, which is an organization that helps elect city, county, and state climate leaders across the country to build the Green New Deal from the ground up through fundraising, get out the vote work, and trainings. And John, you should be able to share your screen. Let me know if you cannot. Great.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Appreciate it, Taylor. Let me just press the present button and then we will get started. It just went up. Sorry. Yeah, thank you for that introduction. My name's John. I work with Lead Locally. We work to elect down ballot city, state, and county climate leaders. And yeah, I'm really excited to be here. It's really cool to hear from such Nancy and Susan and others on, you know, incredible experts on utilities. I feel like a slightly different vibe. I work mostly still in the kind of like organizer campaign framework of it all. And then, you know, the hope is to help elect some of the people who can actually implement some of the things we've been talking about tonight. And I was hoping to talk to y'all tonight about a few things. One, recent public service commission elections. I've heard, you know, we've been talking a lot about PSCs and our statewide utility regulators tonight, as well as what's coming up. Municipal utilities, thinking not just statewide, and like Nancy was saying earlier, our Congress and our federal government, generally, we have a longer timeline to seeing utility-related action on that. So we need to think craftily on like all the levers we have. And so municipal, and not just municipal, but like your own plan for how you can take action on your utility and utility reform outside, regardless of whether you have a direct municipal utility or not. And I will also say there was this excellent article on like how the biggest climate legislation in the IRA could still fail because of public utilities and how elections are a really great way to find yourself, you know, to act on that. And it was a came this journalist wrote this today. It was really funny because he was like, it's a great way to find yourself standing alone. But excited to be here because I know y'all don't feel that way. Just to like kind of lead with what I want to get to by the end, few lessons that like I feel like I've learned from working on utility related elections, which are so part and parcel with organizing around utilities, are that elections just generally can be an incredible tool for organizers locally on utilities and climate and reform. The message really writes itself. Vote for me to fight for clean energy, cheaper rates, and good jobs. Like those things, it so directly hits at some of the top issues of our day, you know, like union, government, often government provided or utility provided jobs, get, you know, paying less for our utility as well as moving, taking action on climate. And can be really, you know, a great message in that way. I will go through some of these state-related utility elections, and you'll notice that a lot of us here won't be able to vote directly on our state-related utilities, our PSCs. And so because of that, that's kind of why I've added some of these other slides, because I think it's really important we get creative and think about and see what other organizers have done, because there are ways to affect how our energy is created generally that aren't just state utilities. And finally, the fossil fuel. One thing I feel like I've learned over and over again is the fossil fuel industry and utilities themselves, particularly private utilities, have endless money. And it's really important to play to our strengths when we think about how we strategize around it, either an organizing or an electoral approach to them. And there are certain ways to do that. And sometimes they mean a longer timeline, and that's okay too. Great. So I'm going to start with a hopeful message, which is that we've had some incredible recent major wins on public service commission related elections that have dovetailed with the changing electorate, you know, the changing demands for climate action and cheaper bills from our utilities. Two in particular I wanted to highlight, who have Stephanie Garcia Richards, who is not directly a utility commissioner, but is related in some ways, and that she gets to decide where New Mexico's energy is coming from. She's the commissioner of public lands, ran directly on a climate-related message and won twice, and has been able to stop fracking and drilling on public lands for several years now. And I will show you her message in a bit. Young Latina woman who ran also partially because there was an old guard of kind of land-related regulators who had kept that position for a long time. And then more directly related to PSCs, Devontae Lewis in Louisiana, a public service commissioner who is in the kind of most Democratic district for Louisiana, the New Orleans-based and part of Baton Rouge district. Devontae outran a Democratic incumbent in the primary about, I think it was a year and a half ago, and who was also very much part of the old guard, and is also the first LGBT statewide elected in Louisiana, and is in his early 30s. And I think just like some lessons from their campaigns and just other successful campaigns we've seen really play to probably many of the organizers here's strengths, that winning PSC campaigns, or I should say, because Stephanie isn't part of a PSC, but like statewide general energy regulating campaigns have centered climate through a really strong renewable energy platform that specifically names weaning utilities and state energy systems off fossil fuels, directly and consistently tackles voters' top issue in terms of their utility, which is its cost. That is like how most people interact with their utility and is what the first thing they think of. So it's really important to name it, and named private utilities in particular as their opposition, and the gas companies in particular, and elected young and diverse candidates that can speak directly to new generations of voters, particularly because we know turnout is so important for these elections and helps decide them, and underscore how out of touch longtime incumbents, often who are accepted lots of money from the very same, you know, industries that these bodies are supposed to regulate, how out of touch they are. And I put here two examples of that. Devontae's solutions, which were kind of just like, he really focused on the exact messaging we just talked about here: tackle corruption, invest in green jobs, clean up the grid so it's resilient, so as Louisiana encounters more and more storms with climate change, that it will not continue to, you know, shut off for many of its customers, and protect ratepayers' rights, which I thought was a really cool, he created the idea of ratepayers' bill of rights to, you know, make sure people are paying a truly fair, affordable rate. And Stephanie here has like, we have earned billions for New Mexicans, tripled renewable energy production, and restored more public land than ever before. I am actually going to do this at the end because I know time is short, but wanted to give, yeah, actually maybe we do have time. So I will show y'all an example of what like I think a successful public service commission race can look like, and how Devontae Lewis in particular was able to kind of thread these messages together.
Louisiana is a place of diversity, culture, food, and a spirit that is unbreakable. The spirit of Louisiana's people may be unbreakable, but our power grid is unsustainable and unreliable. It should be a human right that everyone has access to fresh water, clean air, a cool house in the summer, a warm house in the winter, and utility bills that do not push them further into poverty and that can actually allow them to make their needs met. But sadly, that's not the case in our state. Our storms are getting stronger. The bills keep getting higher. The grid keeps getting knocked out longer, especially in our low-income and Black communities. But for Entergy, their profits are growing, but we are suffering. That's why I'm running for public service commissioner in District 3. The Louisiana Public Service Commission regulates our utility systems, water, sewage, electricity. But for too long, our commissioners have been in the back pockets of Entergy and big corporations and not standing up for the people. As your public service commissioner, I will break energy's grip on our future. I've always stood up against the status quo in this state. I fought in the Louisiana legislature to ensure that
Cool. I'm going to stop there, but wanted to give you all a picture of what it looks like to share my screen again. To kind of, yeah, like to tackle both, speak directly to how climate is part of people's everyday lives, to speak to how like the rates that they're paying impact, you know, like their lives, and also to name specific corporate interests and the people that have like have helped corrupt that body in particular and why he's running. So yeah, as folks are thinking like about how they can like run candidates in particular, I think it's helpful to see like examples that have worked really well. I'll talk a few about some of the states that have upcoming public service commission elections. But wanted to state as this loads that I actually track all the major state utility elections in the country. And most you'll notice that, and I'll send, and Taylor's going to send around the tracker that I use that just looks at like every major public service commission body in the country. You'll notice as you look through it that there are only 10 state like utility bodies in the country that are actually elected. So the vast majority of us live in commissions that are appointed by our state legislature and or our governor, which is an important thing to think about as those races come up and as you kind of plan around how to pressure those people, in particular the governor and state, you know, state legislature around utilities. And Taylor, I know I'll put this in the chat later, but Taylor can also share it later. So there's two/three states I want to highlight as upcoming, both in 2024 and 2025. Those are the only states that have upcoming PSC elections. Montana has an election coming up this November, where there are three districts that have elections. I think what's important to note is that Montana, while still a purple state, has seen higher conservative turnout in recent cycles. So this is a bit of an interesting race in that it is Montana recently had this, you know, I saw someone put it in the chat earlier, Montana versus Held, a very interesting, you know, like climate lawsuit that upheld the rights of the, you demanded that the state take action on climate, I think, believe as part of their constitution. The lawsuit, to my knowledge, actually exempted the Public Service Commission from that ruling, which is kind of a crazy, weird tidbit about that. But all to say, it is somewhere that there has been slower adoption of renewable energy and kind of a confusing partisanship of the state. There are three candidates running: Susan Bilo for Ward 2, Lenny Williams District 3, and Elena Evans as an independent for District 4. In 2020, I worked on a lot of these public service commission races then. Unfortunately, the two major candidates then were completely wiped out in a kind of like pro-Trump movement in Montana. And these maps, as often happens in these states, are very gerrymandered. So it's an interesting election in that it could go really well, but it is very related to the presidential turnout. And the other state that is really important this year is the Arizona Corporation Commission, which is essentially a public service commission in many ways, but yeah, differs slightly and does have a different name. Arizona is one of the country's fastest growing states with some of its hottest cities and highest water scarcity, and has recently had a ton local like of wins for Democrats and climate leaders generally, locally, as well as in their state legislature. And on the Salt River Project, which I'll talk a little bit about more later, it's a municipal utility. And this year we'll have tons of up ballot attention as the Senate seat that Kyrsten Sinema is leaving. As there's a kind of a Dem versus Republican fight for that, which means that these races will also get a ton of attention. Two top Democrats lost in 2020, leaving to only one Democrat left on the commission. And there are three Dems this year for three seats. So the primary in August is kind of irrelevant, and they are voted on at large. So while these are really exciting elections and could change the scope of one of the most important places to move on renewable energy in the country, they also will probably likely be correlated in a big way to turnout for the presidential election because they're at large and not districted. But nonetheless, are really exciting. And all three of these candidates, particularly Aguiar and the candidate at the bottom, whose name I'm forgetting, are really skilled in terms of their like expertise on renewable energy policy. The final one that I think I've seen names here that I think might know this already, but Georgia, Georgia's Public Service Commission, has just endless drama. Incumbents with no term limits. There was a court case led by the Georgia League of Conservation Voters and many others, but just naming them because they're the kind of major climate group that is fighting on this, that forced their Public Service Commission about 2 years ago or a year and a half ago to move from at-large districts, which they contended, and I would completely agree with, failed to represent Black communities in particular. There was a court decision that forced them to move to districted. And then that court decision was reversed. There was an election that was supposed to be held in 2022 because the incumbents had already been in those seats too long. And it didn't happen. And then it didn't happen in 2023. And then it's now no longer going to happen in 2024, apparently, as of a month ago. The Constitution of the state does not have clear guidelines on this body, the PSC. So incumbents are just sitting on the seats unelected for years. And it is, it's kind of in the climate electoral world. It's a big question mark of when these will be, but they will be very important because as was so important in 2020, Georgia is moving blue, led by Black communities, and is, could be a really great place for continued action on the PSC front. Outside of PSCs, I know you just saw probably three states and you're like, well, I don't live in those. There's only so much I can do to take action for them. I kind of wanted to highlight a few ways that you can impact like your utility and energy decisions that are related to your utility locally and statewide where you live, and give a few examples of how organizing groups have done this previously. The first one that I want to give is direct utility control. I think it's really important to check, does your city or where you live or a city nearby control its utility or forms of energy in some way? Does it control a coal plant, a gas plant? Can it produce, any kind of energy infrastructure? And is there a way you could build an electable majority? You could elect a majority to your city council, or maybe you need your mayor, to fight that kind of fossil infrastructure or back new renewable projects and control your energy decisions and your utility in that way. Some examples recently is San Antonio has its own, and Austin have their own municipal utilities. San Antonio managed a coal plant called JK Spruce and was able to close it, unfortunately, converting it to a combination of natural gas and renewables, which is a kind of ongoing fight to just make that renewable. And what really led the way for that was a fight by a variety of local organizations, Move Texas, San Antonio DSA, Sunrise San Antonio, to elect a progressive majority on the San Antonio City Council in 2021. And the other one, and I won't play this, but when the slides are shared, I would encourage y'all to, is that Austin also has its own municipal utility and has a city-owned coal plant called Fayette Coal, which Mike Siegel, who maybe folks know because he previously ran for Congress, is running and just came out with a really bold video with his climate plan, which includes at its forefront closing the Fayette Coal plant and replacing it with a variety of different plans around renewable energy. Says apparently it will reduce their emissions by 76%. I feel like maybe you need to check that, but... there's ways of like, if that is the case for your city, it can be a really strong way to run candidates directly to take that kind of action. Rural public power. Nancy, I believe, brought this up earlier in terms of FDR's electrification policy. That policy led to rural electric cooperatives as well as public power districts, particularly in rural areas. And if you happen to live in one of those, there is tons of money from the Inflation Reduction Act in particular flowing to rural districts and including these entities to help transition to cleaner energy, and is a great campaign message in these areas. Two incredible examples of that are Alaska's Renewable Energy Alaska Project, REAP, which has been electing with our help, actually, which has been great, clean energy candidates to their rural electric cooperatives. Currently, they've elected six of the 30 candidates on the four major RECs in the state. And Arizona's Salt River Project, which I guess is still loading its photo, but is one of the largest municipal utilities or public power utilities in the country for the Phoenix area. Was able to elect two more clean energy leaders to its board earlier this spring. And then I think the other thing I just want to make up room municipal elections directly take on and close fossil fuel infrastructure or things like that. But there's also been really incredible work to create new forms of publicly managed energy by leaning into elections and electoral work and organizing for public power. So there's two ways I wanted to highlight that you could kind of run elections around building public power programs. One is electing pro-public power city and state leaders. New York recently did this over three cycles. There are a coalition of groups came together, Working Families Party, DSA, really, they're huge. You know, it's New York. There's so many groups involved, climate groups, utility accountability groups, to over three cycles, primary Democrats that were resistant to a public power agency, a government-owned agency that could help build energy both more equitably and in regions that the private market, private sector was not going to do. And after three cycles, was able to help build a majority to pass the Building Public Renewable Act, which I think is one of the most exciting public power wins in recent American history. In particular, Sarah Hanna Shrestha in the top right there, she won in the Hudson Valley, which isn't directly in the city, kind of was a huge win and ran really on public power. And these were some of her signs on her campaign, Power for the People, Energy is a Public Good. And this was a rally in direct action at the bottom. And the other thing I'd make a plug for is that the Inflation Reduction Act, and I know you have a future webinar on this, so I won't go more into this, but electing candidates that are specifically running on a campaign to use direct pay and other parts of the IRA to build their own city-owned renewable energy projects that can make use of the kind of benefits that the IRA has, particularly through its direct pay program. The final thing I'll note is that ballot initiatives are a good way to affect your utility. We've seen a lot of action on that in Maine last year and in San Diego this year. I will say it can play to organizer strengths, direct democracy, and clear corporate opponents, but it is also really hard because often ballot initiative money going into them are not restricted very well, and it can be really hard to beat that amount of money. And it also often can lead to really large voter pools, like statewide ballot initiatives that are just harder to affect because sometimes, we just don't have bases that large. So I think things I'll leave you with, ask yourself as you build your utility electoral strategy, is your state utility appointed or elected? Does your city control its utility or any form of energy infrastructure? Who will kind of fight you at either level? Like, who would be your opponent? Who would fund your opposition and put in money into fighting it? Where could you build a majority for utility reform? Is that your state? Is that your city? Where is kind of your ecosystem? Over how many electoral cycles? And what do you actually want to fight for? Any of these options, public power, a PSC, a utility takeover, closing a gas or coal plant, et cetera. I think it's important to also think about what is that perfect mix of both reasonable, but also visionary. And I'll leave you with some thoughts. On the right here is Sarah Hanna's campaign. She ran directly on public power, and her slogan was, "The future must be beautiful," which I thought was really inspiring and really cool that she won. Elections are an incredible tool, and y'all should use them and do so strategically. And I'll pass it back to Taylor.
Awesome. Thank you so much, John. That was great. So now, we're going to jump into Q&A. So if folks want to, and I'm going to spotlight our speakers. If folks want to put your questions in the chat, and we can, we'd love to hear from you. We got a lot of expertise on this call. And I can lift up some things that have come up in the chat so far. I know, I think, yeah, John, when you were talking about like getting people elected to co-ops to get them to shift, Karen mentioned that a lot of the co-ops in North Carolina have exclusive contracts with Duke. And I know that's an issue in some places. I don't know if anyone has. And then Dan shared that New Mexico, a co-op just ended their contract so that it could go renewable. So I don't know if anyone has thoughts on that, like how to kind of take on something like that.
Yeah, well, I'll make a comment. Do you remember, John or Susan? I think it was the Kit Carson co-op, which was one of the first, because I lived in Arizona such a long time that, you know what's going on in New Mexico. And those guys were really, and it must have been the board of directors because they were so forward thinking. And then Holy Cross in Colorado, which was Randy Udall, one of Mo Udall's sons. But when you've got people on the board who are good, they could do a lot.
Yeah, and the other thing to go along with that, which I think John was discussing, is if you live in a co-op jurisdiction, you technically own the utility. So one thing you can do is work to get good board members on the board. They're supposed to be elected periodically and everything like that. And a lot of the co-ops have funky rules to try to prevent people from participating very well. But it's worth the effort if you're in their jurisdiction to put forth your own candidates to challenge these people, many of whom have been on the board for 20 or 30 years and just don't do anything. So at least get them out of their comfort zone, even if you can't win a co-op spot. It makes them have to think more about what they're doing if they're going to be challenged.
What's that? All right, great. We got some good questions here. So Dan is asking, the Mass DPU presented a very climate favorable planning document recently. Have you read it and have comments on it or next steps? It's a very specific question. I don't know if anyone has read that document.
Actually, I have.
Of course you have.
Because we really liked it. Obviously, there's always things that you would do differently, but we actually provided that Massachusetts plan to the Maryland Commission, who's in the process of thinking how it should move ahead with its possible gas transition proceeding. So Massachusetts actually did a very good job. They took probably a little longer than some of us were hoping to get to the plan, but it appears to have been worth the effort because it's a really good solid plan for ultimately getting Massachusetts off of gas.
Yeah. I want to mention something about that too that I loved. And that is that report, The Future of Gas, it was called, I think, Susan Maura Healey's office, is that they basically said RNG, which I've spent some time fighting, renewable natural gas, this crazy idea that you can take landfill gas or swine waste, methane is really what a lot of it is, and turn it into clean natural gas, which is just a fantasy. And so in that report, they said, look, forget renewable natural gas. They basically said, just forget it. You know, it doesn't really reduce greenhouse gases and it'll never work. So that was, to me, that was one of the first official reports I ever saw that was like, no, RNG is it, the dog don't hunt. So.
Yes, at Earth Justice, some of our experts actually did a report on RNG and explained why it won't work. And they also did a report on hydrogen, explained why hydrogen is not a good solution either, but those solutions right now are what will enable the gas companies to keep using their pipes. So they're going to push them everywhere. And sadly, the Biden administration is creating hydrogen hubs and everything to kind of give a little bit of legs to something that shouldn't have any legs at all.
Thanks all. So Phyllis has a great question here. My local utility company has a proposal to the PUC to increase rates. There's a hearing in a few weeks. What comments should I make when I testify? Very practical.
What you can do it on two different levels. You can actually, if you have enough information, attack their increase in rates directly and show how what evidence they're providing doesn't support their increase. And very often that's true because they pad everything. So, but the other thing you do is essentially, particularly if you're doing public comments, to a large extent, you can comment on whatever you want. So you could go in there and comment that rather than having this rate increase, this is what the utility should be spending its money on, and list the things like energy efficiency, like helping with renewables and things like that. Because it's public comments and you're not tied to the evidentiary proceeding, you can say whatever you want and highlight whatever issues you want, by and large.
So, yeah, and I would just say, looking at rate cases, like we had a big one and lots of hearings on it in Maryland against BGE. And I think just having as many people, like bringing as many people with you to come and testify and or to come and submit comments, like I think everyone talked about earlier, just it, you know, it gets them to pay attention because a lot of people don't comment.
Hopefully, like Maryland has a requirement for what's called an evening public hearing, which is essentially a hearing at night so that people who work in other jobs that don't have anything to do with utility regulation can show up. And that's required in their statute that they have to have that hearing. So the whole idea is to get as many people as possible as you can to go out for that hearing, even if all they comment is, I don't want my rates to go up, they're already too high, because at least it reflects to the commission how many people are paying attention.
Awesome. And I see Nancy put some responses to Steve in the chat, pointing out that there actually are a few good utilities out there. And also asking about banks and how banks and utilities work together to fund fossil fuel expansion. I don't know if there's anything else you want to say on that, Nancy, besides what you put in the chat.
Yeah, it's really important because these guys are, you know, that's where they're getting their money from. You know, the other thing to recognize, I think, is that clean energy doesn't have any fuel costs. And when you look at what's going on in the utility world, it's all about fuel volatility right now. And even though coal plants, only 25% of the cost of coal electricity is the fuel, for natural gas, it's more like 70%. I don't know, Susan, do you have any different numbers than that?
No, I think in general, that's the number for a gas-fired electric generator. It's about 70% is the fuel.
Yeah. So that's a weakness. I mean, that's what's going to bite them, frankly. That's what's going to kill them in the end, because gas costs are so volatile. But yeah, funding is everything. And one of the issues that we've been sort of dancing around with friends who are working this for years, is the fact that the utilities use very high discount rates on their fuel costs. Maybe Susan's done some work on that also. And that has the effect of making the future fuel costs look ridiculously low, because they basically discount the cost of fuel 8% per year. So if you look out 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, if gas costs a dollar today, let's just say it costs a dollar, it's probably like about $2 or $2.50 today, a million BTU. You go out 10 years and they're saying it costs only 50 cents. You know, you go out 20 years and they're saying it costs 25 cents. So there's all these things that are sort of baked in to the way that regulators and utilities figure out the cost, that's just so biased for fossil fuels. It's just unbelievable. So I hope that answers the question.
Nancy. Okay, so Dave is asking, what would be the one thing at the federal level that would help every local effort for electrification/decarbonization at the state PUC level?
The one thing, you're looking for the unicorn, huh? Well, if you live in a area that has an RTO, essentially, most of the RTOs at this point are actually helping traditional generation to stay running.
Do you want to explain what an RTO is?
I'm sorry, it's a regional transmission organization. They were supposed to be built to make sure all the power flows between states and that they're sharing things and things like that. And so that you could buy power from a generating station in another state and things like that. But what they're doing now, particularly my focus has been PJM, is they essentially block renewables and things like that by making all these horrible assumptions about their ability to provide power and things like that. And they claim that power plants have to stay up because they're going to be needed to run because these renewables aren't going to be able to serve what they claim they're going to be serving. And they're carrying the utility's water at this point. So essentially challenging the RTO's bias at FERC would actually go far to just kind of breaking the logjam of all these renewables who want interconnection and want transmission and can't get it because the RTOs, like the formulas for Nancy mentioned for gas, the RTOs formula makes all these assumptions about the ability of renewables to perform that just aren't correct. But then it makes the renewables look bad as compared to other generation. So that challenging the RTOs and how they're operating at FERC would be one way to really hopefully at some point break open the logjam and get more renewables.
Yeah, I want to mention something else too, if I can, please, is that it gets complicated. Unfortunately, they make it complicated, I think, that FERC passed this order called 2222. And the bottom line is that it's supposed to allow small-scale renewables to aggregate and bid into the wholesale market. Now, Sunrun did that, and I'll put an example in the chat. So here's what they did. In the New England states, in New England ISO, which is six states, they took 5,000 customers, Sunrun customers. Some had batteries, some didn't. And they're using this software called Brightbox. So they could communicate with all their 5,000 solar customers through this software called Brightbox. And what they did, and it equaled 20 megawatts. And they bid that 20 megawatts of distributed solar into the ISO market. Now, the reason why that is like mind-blowing, makes your hair stand on end if you're an energy person, is that the only players in those markets used to be the giant generators. You didn't have small renewables playing. But FERC Order 2222 is a giant fight right now because, unfortunately, the ISOs, I'd say, are not playing nice. They're not doing what we need. Because if you look in New England, one of the most shocking things I've read in the last couple of months was that there's so much small-scale solar in New England that, if I remember the number right, it was about 4,800 megawatts. That's a huge, huge amount. It was so much that they were able to shut down the Mystic power plant, which is natural gas. So there is real potential for DERs. But as long as FERC is trying to kill it and the state regulators are trying to kill it, sometimes I look at these numbers and I'm shocked that it's doing as well as it is when you consider all the forces lined up against it. So I don't know, Susan, do you have anything to add to that about the DERs in Order 2222?
No, I think it's kind of course, at this point, like you mentioned, the ISOs and RTOs, which ISO is just a form of RTO. They just like to use different words sometimes. But they're slow rolling it. The utilities are slow rolling it. So it really should be a great order that opens it up. But the difficulty is, once again, people aren't implementing it in the way it should be.
And here's another question about specifically about FERC from Andy. So for deregulated markets, I believe FERC has to grant authority for power producers to sell electricity into states. Could this authority approval be conditioned by FERC on something like clean energy composition of the electricity being sold, or would something like that have to be legislated if it is even a good leverage point to force transition?
I think it would have to be legislated because essentially what they approve is kind of generator by generator. So you get permission to sell your generation into the wholesale, what's called the wholesale market. So you would only have a generator. So for them to say you have to also have something else, I think you would have to have legislative authority to do that.
Yeah, I agree.
Cool. And then James has, go ahead, Nancy.
Sorry, you could, do you remember, Susan? Allison Clements, one of the reasons why Manchin would not let her be chair, she had been arguing for, I believe it was years in many dockets, to have climate change taken into account in FERC rules, right? And so that would have been a FERC decision. And I understand that's why they did not make her chair since the Republicans are in charge. So there are ways you can do it. And it would be, but FERC needs a lot of pressure. Mm-hmm. They need pressure.
Yeah. I was focusing more on the specific question of, could you require them to do renewables at the same time they're doing other power? I think that would be difficult because it's supposed to be a competitive market. But if the standard you want is the standard they've adopted in Maryland and other states, that the commission itself has to consider climate change before it approves anything, then that could actually be, particularly with regard to their gas pipeline authority and things like that, that could be a way to simply deny permits for people rather than deny and make them do something else. That and make them do something else, I think, is the step that only the legislature can do. But they can deny a permit, and then if people want to do something, they'll think of a way to add something to it to make it more palatable, but that would be their own choice, not for telling them what to do.
Awesome. And James has outlines a little bit here of some work, some trying to submit comments and feeling like not being listened to, like Northwestern, this is in Montana, Northwestern Energy seems to own their PSC, like, and there's hearings, but it feels like lip service. Like, what do you say to people who do engage in this process, but are feeling like they aren't being heard?
Well, we actually have an office in Montana that participates in the Montana Commission all the time. And what you have to do is kind of, there's strength in numbers. So get as many people as you can to file comments, get as many people as you can to participate in the hearings. And you just have to kind of keep showing up and making it clear you're not going away, that this is an issue that's too important. And that then, I mean, I don't know if there's any Montana legislator who's a Democrat, but you know, that then you can get a legislator involved because you've shown up a large group of people who are interested in this issue. If you want their votes, you may need to do something about it. Now, in Montana, there aren't really large groups of people. But that's how it is. You just have to keep showing up and keep building your numbers so that it puts pressure on them that they can't. And the other thing that does is, if you raise an issue and the Montana Commission ignored you, that's a grounds for appeal. You know, they can't ignore an issue. They have to address it, even if they're going to disagree with you. So if you keep raising issues that make them uncomfortable, a lot of times they will try to avoid discussing them at all because they don't have any real good response. But that creates an issue that you could get them overturned later, or get a Montana court to say something that's good and in your favor. But just, and I know it's difficult. I mean, I've been doing this for decades. You just have to keep showing up and keep making your arguments and keep trying to build momentum with more people.
Yeah, I agree. And we had we're experiencing a win with Third Act, that I hope so. We have some third actors who knew some legislators. And so they're working with this legislator right now on a bill for solar, for more, you know, for distributed solar. So you never know when these things are going to show up. You know, remember when I was working for the commissioner in Arizona and all the right wingers won, and it was just me and him and all the right wingers. And it was like, no, you're going to kick our butts, but we're going to make a stand. And you can say that you don't care, but you can't say that you didn't know. And I personally would not be surprised as we move into an era where all the old fossils start to, you know, go away, that, and the young people come in and say, look, you're not going to destroy my world, okay? That those types of stands are going to make a difference. Because again, they can't say they didn't know. And in 20 years of this work, I see an outpouring of interest, concern, sophistication, collaboration that I have never seen before, that is pretty exciting.
The other thing is the uniting with strange bedfellows issue. There was a green tea movement for a while because, quite frankly, pretty much it doesn't matter what political party you belong to, you hate your utility. So you can pull in people who are maybe conservative or libertarian if you give them ways. This is a way to not have your utility. Having rooftop solar and battery backup in your basement is a way you can tell your utility you don't want nothing more to do with them. So you can pull in people who aren't necessarily interested in climate, but have other reasons to want to stop the utility from stopping them from getting what they want, which may be just simply not have to have this utility.
John, did you want to jump in?
Yeah, I think the only thing on like strange bedfellows, I think New York, trying to think of some other examples of this, but like another bedfellow that I would consider other, I agree with partisanship, but also because there's so much kind of like distrust and distaste for utilities, but also labor. Like thinking through an early labor movement plan for whatever you're fighting for, whether that's, you know, demanding a stronger clean energy transition plan, public power, net metering, whatever it is. I think like whether labor is on your side or even not opposed or on your side, but quiet because they kind of tacitly endorse what you're doing, but they're for a variety of reasons not vocal. Early and consistent engagement with the unions, I think, can also, I feel like I've seen, be a really big decider of which utility-oriented organizing and elections have, you know, have teeth.
Awesome. There are more questions in the chat than we are going to have time to get to tonight. So would definitely recommend that folks, you know, I'm happy to follow up with people offline, but also if, I don't know if our speakers are open to getting questions offline, but that would be amazing. Certainly. Thank you so much. And yeah, we will share all of the, I will do my best to collect all of the links in here and share them all out along with the recording of this. And yeah, so I think we can go into wrap up. Yanni, if you want to pull up our slides again.
Sorry, 1 second. Always. Here. Okay.
Well, yeah, so like I mentioned at the beginning, so this is part of our series, our public education series. So this is our fourth one. We have three coming up in June. So we've got next week, June 4th, we have power mapping and campaign research, and that's going to be run by Little Sis. And this is like super useful for any type of campaign that you're working on. If you're going to go through, if you're going to, you know, look at public utility commissions, if you're going to take a like a legislative approach or a ballot initiative approach or any of the other kind of strategies we've talked about in some of the other sessions, power mapping and like doing the research ahead of time like is really important. So really recommend joining us next week to dig into that. And Little Sis has a bunch of really cool like open source tools to help you with that. And then June 11th is a training that John mentioned. We are having this training on the IRA direct pay program, which is a part of the IRA, which allows you to get like federal money to build renewable energy projects in your community. So we will dig into all of that and how you can actually access that money. And then June 18th, we're going to do some trivia from all of the sessions, whether it's okay if you weren't able to attend all of them. But if you did, then you will probably win. And just, you know, a little celebration of all of the knowledge we've gained. And then we'll take a break for a few weeks. And then in July, we'll come back to do some more skills-based work around, especially around narrative and storytelling. So would love for you to come to some of our upcoming sessions. Next slide. And yeah, there's a few things to, if you want to do tonight, I'm going to put these in the chat. So you can join our Slack, which we have for, it's like for any 350 affiliated volunteer. We're just trying to create more kind of open lines of communication, both like with staff, but also with each other. Like there was a lot of good back and forth in the chat here. Like there's a lot of expertise within this community. So we want you to be able to talk to each other more directly. The link to register for future sessions, the ones I just talked about, is in there. And then also there's a Google form to give us feedback. We love hearing how these sessions are going, how they're, if there's any changes you would like us to implement. And yeah, thank you all so much for joining us tonight. Thank you so much to our speakers for all of your expertise, for fielding all these questions. Really, really appreciate you sharing your wisdom with us. So thank you.
Thanks everybody for listening and caring.
Thank you all. Really appreciate it.